I mean, here y'all, it's like we're singing by ourselves up here.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. How is that? Yeah.
That's one song.
Oh, okay. Come on.
Yeah, I just heard it in the corner. My throat is bad.
Hello?
Moving on.
one more special.
We do?
Yeah.
And we need to take up prayer requests and pray.
I don't think I did that. Aren't you trying to find somebody that keeps seeing the word of this?
Gotta get our band ready. I got a testimony. Anybody have a testimony? Amen.
go there as a break on this. Something deep in your life, and so, and she's seeking prayer from all the brothers and sisters. Where God is very glory to worship you and God. Well, Jennifer here has something she wanted to say.
I just wanted to say that I wanted to thank Desmarie and Desmar because if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be here today.
Amen.
And then again, because you guys started it, and then you guys told me, and then you helped me get through it. But I also wanted to say, no matter how hard it gets, God will always be there for you. And I hope whatever Desmarie is going through, she can get past it.
Amen.
And I want to say, have a great day.
Amen.
Before, whether we're young Christians growing in faith, or whether we're more mature, we all need help. We all need answers, and that's what's nice about the body of Christ. We can come together and share one another's thoughts and feelings, and you know, that's what makes the family of God so unique, that we can do things that the world laughs at, scoffs at, because it's not necessary. Is there any prayer requests here that the people have, that I have, that he needs? Here has an individual need. And God knows what it is. So if you'd like to come up and pray,
Savior above that is there to help us through any difficulties we might face. We promise never to leave or forsake us. And we know that that promise is for sure. It's for that promise. So, Father, I just want to thank you for each one of us here tonight. May we all receive a blessing from one another. We are here to edify one another, to encourage, to help us get through the troubling times. Lord, you know that this world is facing so much trouble today. Lord, we know that this isn't the end. We don't have to be doom and gloom, because as Christians, you want us to know your plan. You want us to know what lies ahead, so that we can be prepared for anything that comes our way. Even the pastor and his family as they continue to make you watch over this evening. May your spirit take the words given tonight and use it to edify you and to help us understand. Lord, we just thank you for Jesus and all that he has done for us. He's done more than we can ever think of. So, Father, we lift up his name and just glorify his name. He is the creator. He holds everything together. Father, we just thank you in Jesus' name. We thank you. We thank you. We love you. We just want more of you. Lord, we give this all to you in his precious name. Welcome to Trigonometry 101. We've got a good Bible study. But I want to try to wrap this up, and we're going to be in Ezekiel 38 and 39. I want to try to get through this tonight. And you think, let's see how many I have here. 1, 2, 7, 8. Pass these out to everyone, please. Just lay it underneath. There's enough there for everybody to have if they want. Yeah, a little sickness. I'll be back from last week's sermon, so it's not a sermon this time. But we've been talking about the situation that is developing in Ukraine and going on right now. And some of you may have wondered if this was leading up to what was called the Gagarin War. And I just want you to know this is my personal understanding. And if you have any objections to what I say, you know, what I'm saying is not concrete, but I try to do most of it in line with what the Bible says. And just to refresh a little bit, we look back at how this all began. You know, we talked about the Table of Nations, how all the nations developed and how everything came about. And, you know, you can go through each one of those you can go through each one of those and find out where all these countries are that existed back then, so they still do. But the geographical area that we're talking about is still there. Maybe changed a little bit, but they're still there. You know, we ask the question, who is God? Well, we know in chapter 38, we know that God is a prince. Verse 3 says he's the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. And that God is against it. To have God against you, you have no chance. So whatever is going to take place, God has already told him that he's against it. We know that he's going to put a hook in their jaw, and he's going to pull them down towards Israel, along with the alliance that he talks about here in chapter 38, verses 5. We know that Meshach and Tubal, Persia, Ethiopia, Libya, Gomer, all bands, the house of Tugano, of the north corner, and all his bands and many people with him. Now, we don't see any of that developing right now. We see Russia mainly involved in Ukraine. But as far as the other countries, we haven't heard anything about their movement yet. But when you start to see these countries, these Islamic countries that we just mentioned here, when you start to see them moving, now whether or not we'll be here, I don't know. I don't know if we'll see them coming or not. Nobody knows, you know, when the rapture is going to take place. But Jesus told his disciples, like a fig tree, when you start to see it blossom, you can tell that summer is near. So when you see these countries that are involved, Russia is a big one, that's mainly involved. It has ties with Syria right now. It's got ties with Iran. And the players are there. Their timing hasn't taken place yet. The timing for them to be involved hasn't taken place yet. But what I would like to do is look at God's and his first optimal plan. And God's intention was to end sin and the world as we know it at the end of Daniel's 70th week. You heard of Daniel's 70th week, right? And there was to only be one advent of the Messiah if the Jews had been faithful to their calling and fulfilled all God asked them during their 70 weeks of captivity in Babylon. Messiah would have established his kingdom on earth, sitting at the throne of David for 1,000 years. Now look at that first illustration I got for you. This is the timeline of the Old Testament, from Adam until God was going to set up his eternity. So the way it was supposed to work was that when Nebuchadnezzar, or Cyrus, gave the okay for them to go and build the temple, it was going to be a 7-week time frame. And a week in those days, back then, a week represented 7 years. So you see that there are a total of 490 years. And At the crucifixion, it was supposed to be, it had to be cut off. When it was cut off, the price was cut off. It would be 483 years up to that point. So, 7 years remaining was going to be the tribulation. And after the tribulation, Christ was come to come down and establish his kingdom on earth here for 1,000 years, and then we would live in eternity. But something happened during that time frame that didn't work out like it was supposed to, and that was when the Jews rebelled against. See here on the back page, it's going to be the 483 years up to the cross, but then something was to change. God told the Jewish people that they were to be a kingly priesthood. And they were throughout the land, people would come to them and say, I want to go to your God, I want to be part of your God. But it didn't work out that way. So after the crucifixion, the 483 years, Paul says that the Jews were partly blaming. So when God did that, he opened the door for the Gentiles to become church that would be the Gentiles till the Gentiles cup had been filled up. But after the cross, after the ascension, Jesus rose up, and the age of grace started, and we are still in that moment of time till the rapture takes place. And then once the rapture takes place, then it's going to revert back to what this first sheet is supposed to do. And that's when the Jews become the priestly ones at the end of at the kingdom, at the 1,000 years of kingdom. But we're in that age of grace right now. We're in that time frame where the church, the Gentile church, is the cup is being filled. We don't know when that will be filled. Only God knows that. You know, it's like the movie you guys saw Saturday, Before the Wrath. How many of you have ever seen that? That was a very, very good movie. While I was sick, I was able to find it on the Fire Stick and watched it. I mean, that was so amazing how that wedding, the Galilee wedding, you know, bride has to be prepared for who knows how long until the father says it's time for the son to go get his bride. And that's where we're at right now. We're in that part of that wedding where we have to be prepared, always looking for the return of Jesus Christ. Because like it said, he's going to be like a thief in the night. It's going to be so quick. When God tells his son to go get his bride, you know, that's the rapture. And that's when it's we're going to be out of here, and we're going to be rejoicing with Jesus in heaven and have a good time. So as we continue on with this, we know that many names, if I mentioned earlier, have changed, but the masses, the land mass still exists today because the Jewish people, why? Because they profane the name of Jehovah. They profane defend his name, his commandments, his statutes, his Sabbath, his ordinances. And God allowed a Gentile king to invade and capture them for a time such as this. In Ezekiel chapter 20, just back a few pages here, Ezekiel 20, 19 through 26, says, I am the Lord your God, walk in my statutes and keep my judgments and do them. Hallow my Sabbath, and they shall be a sign between me and you, that you may know that I am the Lord your God. Notwithstanding, the children rebelled against me. They walked not in my statutes, neither kept my judgments to do them. Which if a man do, he shall even live in them. They polluted my Sabbath. Then I said, I will pour out my fury upon them, to accomplish my anger against them in the wilderness. Nevertheless, I withdrew my hand and wrought for my name's sake, that it should not be polluted in the sight of the heathens, in whose sight I brought them forth. Excuse me. So, just in those few verses, God is not doing it for Israel's sake. He's doing it for his name's sake, because of what they have done and the rebellion against him. So he withdrew his hand from them, 22, that it should not be polluted in the sight of heathens, and whose sight I sought them for. I lifted up my hand unto them, also in the wilderness, that I would scatter them among the heathens and disperse them throughout the countries, because they have not executed my judgments, but have despised my statutes. They had polluted my Sabbaths, and their eyes were under their father's idols. Wherefore I gave them also statutes that were not good, and judgments whereby they should not live. And I polluted them in their own gifts, in that they caused to pass through the fire all that openeth the womb, that I might make them desolate to the end, that they might know that I am the Lord. So in verse 26, God's saying that even when their children were born, you remember that idol that they would take and place the child and sacrifice on that iron statue with his hands out, they would place that. Can you just imagine the horror and the screams of this little baby like that? God's looking at this country on the abortion that's going through. God is going to judge this country because of what's happening with abortion, what's happening with marriage, what's happening with all kinds of stuff. Because we are turning our back on him, and he's not going to let us profane his name much longer. So, Ezekiel was trying to teach the Jewish people their heritage that was wasting away, reminding the youth of their father's covenant with Jehovah, the promised land that Jehovah had given to Abraham, but they had become stiff-necked and rebellious people. Remember what Stephen told them when he was preaching to them there in the book of Acts? He called them a stiff-necked people. And so from the time of King Nebuchadnezzar, captain of Judah, began what is known as the time of the Gentiles. Israel has been under Gentile occupation of one sort or another for up to now. And you and I are still in that time frame. God is still filling his cup with saints till it's full and no more rules available. Now we know that the battle of God, a Magog battle, is still future. It hasn't started yet. We can see, remember I told you about a picture puzzle? And you could have 75% of it complete. You can see the what it might look like. But that 25% is still missing. That's what's going on right now. There's pieces of that puzzle that are still missing. And they're going to slowly come into evidence, and they'll be, God, when God's ready for them, they'll be placed where they should be. So it's, you know what, Jesus was saying that fig tree starts to blossom in the summertime, you know, summertime of the earth. Ezekiel saying that the battle will start in the summertime? No, I don't believe so. When you start to see the bud of the fig tree blossom and movements of these Islamic nations that we talked about earlier begin to amass and move towards the mountains of Israel, and Russia establishes a connection with them, then begin to know that God's hook in the jaws of Meshach and Tubal, which is Turkey, Persia, which is Iran, Ethiopia, which is not the country of Ethiopia, but it's an area in the Sudan area, which is on the east side of Egypt, going up into the eastern corner there, in Libya, which is towards the upper middle of Africa, over that way, that includes some of those other countries. Gomer and Tugarma are being put into action. Look at the second page here of the handout. I'm trying to illustrate for you all these countries that is, it's talked about in chapter 38, their location. And we can try to visualize how these countries are going to come from their different areas. They're going to come down towards the mountains of Israel. And in Saudi Arabia, where you see Sudan and Yemen, those are the old countries of Saudi Arabia. And we'll read here in a moment how these countries like this are asking, hey God, why are you coming down this way? What are you after? Are you after a booty? What are you after? But we'll get to that here in a little bit too. So, now, Russia has just recently asked China for military help, and we could possibly see a new player being pulled into this relationship with Russia, and that is China, and more likely, they don't even understand what's going on. You know, China's a big communist, atheist nation, so they probably don't understand what their involvement with this will be. But if you turn to Revelations chapter 16, we'll see that mentioned in just a second here. And this involves the sixth vial that is being poured out. And I'm going to try, again, from my understanding of how this works out, I'm going to try to show you how these, I believe, that these first six vials are going to be tied in with what God is pouring out in this Magog war. But in verse 12 of Revelation 16, it says, and the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. Now, the kings of the east could represent China, but I'm sure it's going to represent some of those areas of that area, because the Bible says it's going to be like a 200 million man army that's going to come across that Euphrates. And what in the country right now has the capability of deploying that many soldiers? But China. So judgment that dries up the river. Now the Euphrates has 22 dams located on it throughout its stretch. And it could be very easy to stop and divert some of the flow so the kings of the east could cross over. If that's the way it works, I don't know. It just says that it dries it up. Do they dry it up by cutting off the water? I don't know. But there's the possibility, you know, that dams today can be manipulated where water should be stopped from flowing. So we just have to, I hope we're not here when that happens, but if we are, if it does happen while we're still here, we know that that's what that is. So what would entice God to go down and take spoils in Ezekiel 38:10? I think when I left you that first week, that's where I left off. And 38:10 says, thus the Lord God, it shall also come to pass that at the same time shall things come into thy mind, and thou shalt think an evil thought. What is it that could possibly cause God to continue his movement? Is Russia preparing itself in a way that it will be established in that area? And we don't know how this Ukraine thing is going to end up. But let's just say that it ended up where Russia takes, you know, half the country. Somebody, they were saying they would, if they could take Kiev, which is the capital, and slice it in half, that they would call it quits. If that's a reasonable thought, what is going to entice God to want to go down and seek the spoils from Israel? Well, if you've studied about the discoveries that have been made in Israel, you know that God promised them a land flowing with milk and honey. When Solomon built the first temple, he had it covered with what? Remember? All the furniture and the implements were covered with gold. And there's other precious metals. There's other minerals. Oil and natural gas deposits have been found off the coast of Israel. Young lady, if you were to go to a candy store and just be free to do what would you want, what would you try to do? Would you try to grab everything you could? There you go. And that's what I think that is going to entice them, is not only the oil and the gas deposits, but also the other minerals. There's huge amounts of potash, and I just couldn't write everything down, but there's a lot of valuable minerals that are in the Dead Sea. And so it's something that could entice them. I'm not saying that it will, but I'm just saying that it could entice them. Now, if you look at that third page on the handout, you can see the deposits of oil and natural gas. This includes both of them, oil and natural gas. But in 2016, this Leviathan oil field, they discovered billions of cubic feet of natural gas that Israel is using to supply Egypt and Jordan. You know, I mean, if you're a country like Russia, and you know they're having sanctions put on them, and you want another resource to grab a hold of, that has a lot of natural gas in it. Would you want to go for that? Oil also. You can see some of these future discoveries here that have been made and where they're supposed to start. So there's actually one, two, three. The Carish development is already going. But right there is enough to entice somebody that's greedy, that needs the resource, that is looking to be a power in the world. So that's another reason that they could be like in a candy store and just try to grab all that stuff that they could. Israel is surrounded by hostile nations, mainly Islamic ones, Iran, which is Persian, the Bible wants to blow Israel off the map. And I know you've heard that before. Israel, Iran wants to blow them off the map. Even notice when you fill the bathtub, and you unclog or open the tub and drain it, it starts out slow, doesn't it? And the further it gets empty and empty, it just speeds up. It gets quicker and quicker and quicker. That's what's going to happen. It gets closer to empty, it speeds up and faster and faster. And this is what's happening with prophecies today. Events will start to happen and they happen very quickly. Be prepared as a bride waits for the bridegroom. You know not the time of his appearing. As a child of God, we don't want to be caught napping. Excuse me for Facebook. I hope I'm not blowing your ears off. But let's here, hit that thing caught your throat. They call it a frog. Shall come across the land of Israel. So we know God is going to get down into the mountains of Israel. Saith the Lord God, that my fury shall come up in my face, for in my jealousy, and in my fire of my wrath, have I spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel. So we know that when God gets down into the mountain areas of Israel, that God is going to let his fury come loose. He's going to come up, and he's a jealous God. In the fire of my wrath have I spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel. It's going to be, it doesn't call it an earthquake, but what else, how else do you describe it? A shaking of somewhere, whether it's an earthquake or what's going to happen. That's going to be the first thing. So that the fishes of the sea, and the fowls of the heaven, the beasts of the field, and all creepy things, they creep upon the earth. And what does it say? And all the men that are upon the face of the earth. This is not going to affect just Israel, but all men that are upon the face of the earth are going to know shall shake at my presence, and the mountains shall be thrown down, and the steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground. Now that sounds like a major earthquake, doing damage like that. And in verse 21, it says, I will call for a sword against him throughout all my mountains, said the Lord God. Every man's sword shall be against his brother. So what's going to happen? Through all this shaking and stuff that's going on, all the mountains that are falling, there's probably going to be a lot of dust in the air where, again, I'll just speculate, but it's going to cause these people to take a sword and fight against each other. They're not going to know who they're fighting against because it's obvious it's going to be so cloudy and obscure that they're not going to recognize who they're fighting. They're just going to start stabbing. Verse 22, and I will plead against him with pestilence. All right, this is the first plague out of six that God is doing. And I will plead against him with pestilence, blood, number two, and I will rain upon him and upon his band and upon the many people that are with him. Plague number three is rain. And it's going to be an overflowing rain. Great hailstones. Four. Fire is five. And brimstone is six. And he's doing this so that he can magnify myself and sanctify myself. And I will be known in the eyes of many nations. And they shall know that I am the Lord. So, here's where I'm going to try, and Revelations, go back to Revelations 16. And this is, you don't have to agree with me, that's fine, but search the Bible out. I'm not trying to tell you something to lead you astray. You know, this is just my understanding of what will take place, that in chapter 16, as the vials of the earth of God are poured upon the earth, and John says in chapter 16, verse 1, and I heard a great noise out of the temple saying to the seven angels, go your way and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. It says, and the first went and poured out his vial against the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sores upon the men which had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worshipped his name. Now, go back here to verse 22 of Ezekiel 38, and he says, I will plead against him with what? Pestilence. What is pestilence? Well, it could be anything from sores to diseases or what? And what does the first vial say? He's going to pour out a vial that gives him grievous sores upon him. And then the second vial in verse 3. And the second vial poured out his vial upon the sea, and it became as the blood of a dead man, and every living soul died in the sea. And what's the second one that he's going to do? After pestilence, and with blood. Then vial number three, and the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and fountains of water, and they became blood. I heard the angels of the water say, thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and was and shall be because thou hast judged us. For For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, and thus have given the blood to drink. For they are worthy. And I heard another come out of the altar, even so, Lord God Almighty. True and righteous are their judgments. So, right there, there's a lot of blood involved. The fourth vial of Revelation 16:8, and the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and power was given on him to scorch men with fire. And where do we find the fire? Well, we have to go down here after the great hailstorms, and there's fire. There's fire going to be involved in this invasion that May God puts on Israel. And then was scorched with great heat and blasphemed the name of God, which had power over these plagues, and they repented not to give him glory. So God has given them a chance to repent, but it's not happening. Now let's look at the fifth vial. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast. And his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain, and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds. So again, we see where the pestilence back up here is involved again. And the sixth vial, chapter verse 12, and the sixth angel poured out his vial against the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the earth might be prepared. Now, again, whether that is through, you know, manipulations of the dams or what, it doesn't say. It just says that it's going to be dried up. But with all the heat that's going on and the fires, I just can't imagine what these people would be going through. And so, drop down here to verse 17. And the seventh angel poured out the vial into the air. There came great voices out of the temple of heaven and the throne, saying, "It is done." And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was great earthquakes, such as not since men were upon the earth, so mighty as earthquakes and so great. So, again, that's just my understanding of this little section here in Ezekiel, that these plagues that God is going to put on them, I believe it was tied into the vials. But again, I don't know. I don't know for sure. You just have to research that yourself, and just to me, it seems reasonable that that's what it could be. So, in chapter 39, we see how this is going to be. "Therefore, son of man, prophesy against God and say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee, O God, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. I will turn thee back and leave but the sixth part of thee." Now, we don't, the Bible doesn't tell us. It just tells us that there are going to be bands from Meshach and Tubal troops. Magi, Persia, Tagarma, Libya, Sudan, Ethiopia. Don't know how many thousands, hundreds of thousands, or even maybe close to millions. We don't know. But God is taking out 5/6 of those. Now, if you had 60,000 troops and you took out 50% of those, what do you got left? Pardon? 30,000? Well, I was thinking 10,000 myself, but I don't know. If you take out 50% of that, that leaves, oh no, that's not right. Anyway, whatever it turns out to be, 5/6 of that, those armies will be wiped out. And here's what's going to happen. God says that I will cause thee to come from up from the north parts, and will bring thee upon the mountains of Israel. I will strike thy bow out of the left hand, and will cause thy arrows to fall out of the right hand. They shall fall upon the mountains of Israel, thou and all thy bands, and the people that are with thee. I will give thee into the ravenous birds of every sort, to the beasts of the field, and to be devoured. Thou shalt fall upon the open fields, for I have spoken it, says the Lord God. And I will send a fire on Magog, and among them that dwell perilously in the isles, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Now, Magog, the coastly parts of her, in the southern part of Russia, they are the countries that have the stand at the end of it, you know, like Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, whatever the other stands are. But these are mainly in the coastal areas, and God says he's going to wipe them out with fire. And verse 7, so I will make my holy name known in the midst of my people Israel, and I will not let them pollute my holy name anymore, and the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, the Holy One in Israel. So again, Israel is not involved in this war, other than their country is being invaded. God is doing this all himself. Because if his name has been profaned, he's not going to let it happen anymore. In verse 8, behold, it is come that it is done, said the Lord God. This is the day whereof I have spoken. This is the day that he has spoken through the prophets of time past. And it has now finally come to an end. And that they may dwell in the cities of Israel shall go forth and shall set and burn the weapons. The cities of Israel shall go forth and shall set on fire and burn the weapons, both the shields and the bucklers, the bows and the arrows, and the handstaves and the spears, and they shall burn them with fire for 7 years. Now, there are people that have discussed this and kind of say that the Bible is not really talking about bows and arrows and bucklers and shields. The shields, you know, were all wooden. The spears were all wooden. And he said, I will call him throughout my mountain, saith the Lord God, every man's sword shall be against his brother. And some people believe that these people that invade will actually be on, it talks about horses. They'll be riding their horses. They'll be with their bows and their arrows.